grace and peace to you from Jesus Christ, our resurrected Savior and Lord. A couple of announcements before we begin our worship service this morning. First of all, Women's Fellowship will be meeting following worship up here or downstairs?
Up here.
Up here. Okay, up here, Women's Fellowship after our worship service today. Secondly, there is an open house, a public open house for the Oceana County Council on Aging building this afternoon. I believe that's from 1 to 4, and everyone is invited to attend and check out their new building out there. Also, another opportunity at the Hart Commons comes at 5 o'clock this afternoon, a prayer vigil for the hostages taken in Haiti. And so many opportunities for our congregation following worship this morning. Do you have announcements? Then let's begin worship. Nancy? And able for our call to worship. Come and worship.
God is here.
Listen for God's still speaking voice.
God is alive and active.
Draw near to the source of mercy and love.
God gracious is with us now and always.
Be thou my vision. It's number 382 in our hymnals.
Thou my best, all of mine. mercy.
Give us courage to cry out in our need when the crowds seek to silence us. Give us the wisdom to admit our limitations and accept our limited understanding. Give us the confidence to sing your praises in the midst of our fears and doubts. Grant us your healing balm, O God, that we may be truly made well and whole and follow you all the days of our lives. Amen.
You may be seated.
This morning our scripture lesson comes from Mark's Gospel, again from the 10th chapter. We'll be reading about Bart, and I don't mean Simpson. Thank you. Then they would be Jesus and the disciples. Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." And so they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, Bartimaeus jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" Bartimaeus said, "Rabbi," or "teacher, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has healed you." Immediately, Bartimaeus received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. Words from our still speaking God. See when you look in the mirror? Yourself? Okay. What do you look like? Oh, who?
Yourself.
Oh, yourself. Okay. I want to encourage you the next time you look in the mirror, which will be in about 2 minutes. I want you to look deeper and look a little deeper and see if you might find a child of God looking back at you. Because that's what you are. Okay? Let's pray. Holy God, we thank you for our children, whether they are young or old, or somewhere in between. We thank you, God, for the children that your Son especially blesses. We thank you for the blessing that they are in our own lives and in the life of our congregation. recognize what we do see when we look in the mirror. Now, to help us in this exercise, I have even provided mirrors, and I hope everyone got one as you were coming in this morning. There we go. Everybody needs a mirror. Open them up. Open them up and take a look. Like someone who is a follower of Jesus? Does the image look like someone who is a disciple? This morning, we're going to meet Bartimaeus, blind man who lived in the city of Jericho, a blind man who perhaps could see more clearly than even some of Jesus' closest friends and followers. Let's pray. Holy and merciful God, welcome and love all those whom you have created and are made in your image. Help us to see the mystery of your image in everyone that we encounter, whether they be family or friend, stranger or even enemy. Teach us to find joy and meaning in the beauty of one another and in the wisdom of your holy word. Amen. Jesus and his disciples were passing through Jericho. They were getting ready to make the 15-mile trek up to Jerusalem, where the cross awaited. Now, Jesus had warned his disciples three times that he was going to Jerusalem to die. And each time, the disciples failed to understand what he was talking about. Even earlier on the road to Jerusalem, James and John, two of Jesus' most trusted and earliest called disciples, had come to Jesus with a request to sit one at his right and one at his left when Jesus came into his glory. Now, Zebedee's boys, if you'll remember, Zebedee's boys thought that glory meant an earthly king sitting on the throne of Israel. Jesus warned them again that his throne would not be the kind that they were hoping for, and that he had come to give his life as a ransom for many. Even though the disciples had been with Jesus a long time, almost 3 years, they still couldn't see the truth about who Jesus was and where Jesus was leading them. But a blind man, it took a blind man to see the truth. And when Jesus passed by, Bartimaeus began to shout, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me." Now, maybe it's interesting that Bartimaeus called Jesus the Son of David, the Son of King David. King David, who would have been the image of one of those earthly kings, one of those kings of power that would rule the earth. Bartimaeus saw that in this son of David. But I think Bartimaeus also sees that Jesus, that this son of David, came not so much with wrath, with militaristic power, but rather this son of David came with mercy. Mercy in his heart. Mercy for everyone, whom he encountered, mercy for even those whom he didn't encounter. "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me," is the cry of one who sees more of who Jesus really is than those 12 whose eyes were supposedly functioning normally. Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus knows who he is. And set as an alternative, really, by the gospel writer to James and John, who only wanted earthly power and glory, those seats of honor on either side of an earthly king. Bartimaeus, a beggar, he just wants some mercy. He just wants to see again. He's not interested in earthly power. He just wants to be a part of the mainstream culture. Because you see, in Jesus' day, people who suffered from physical maladies, blindness, skin diseases, leprosy, they were viewed as unclean. They were viewed as broken. They were viewed as necessarily suffering because of a lack of faith. They were suffering because God was making them suffer as some kind of punitive. How entity would have looked at blind Bartimaeus. That's why they tried to be quiet, old man. Don't bother the rabbi. All Bartimaeus wanted was a little mercy. He didn't want to sit in seats of glory. I'm not sure Bartimaeus would have even cared if his name made it into what would become our Holy Bible. He just wanted mercy. He just wanted to fit in. Sons of thunder. Jesus stands still, mostly so that Bartimaeus could find his way to Jesus. You do realize that a physically blind person finds it hard to find a moving target. So Jesus stands still, and Bartimaeus is brought to him, and Jesus asks Bartimaeus the very same question that he asked Zebedee's boys. What would you like me to do for you? And again, instead of asking for glory, for fame, for fortune, Bartimaeus just asks for some mercy. I want to see again. I want to see so I won't be an outcast. I want to see so maybe even my family will accept. Jesus says, go. Your faith has made you well. And immediately in saying that, Bartimaeus has his physical sight. But Bartimaeus does something amazing. You know, we usually think that we need to be obedient to Jesus. But did you notice as I read the story that Bartimaeus was not obedient to Jesus' request when he said, go, your faith has made you well. What did Bartimaeus do instead? He followed Jesus. He followed Jesus, praising him. Glorifying him, not himself, Bartimaeus became a follower of Jesus, the Son of David. So, here we are this morning, gifted with little mirrors that I found on Amazon. I've got one too. I'll do what all of you wanted to do and sometimes I think we get blinded by the various and sundry lights of our day. We get blinded to the ways of discipleship, the ways of obedience, to the ways of faithful and faith-filled following, those that like alliteration. we are blinded to our own needs. We're blinded even to our own needs of having Jesus in our lives, of having mercy and grace, the mercy and grace of God through the Son of David bless us and embrace us and hold us accountable for our sometimes spiritual blindness and the sin that flows from it. Sometimes I think blind to the claim that Jesus, the Son of David, places on our lives. We become blind to the priority of worshiping and praising the Almighty. We let other worldly things into our lives that blind us from our calls for Christ. Christ to follow and to serve, to humble ourselves and love everyone. This little story of Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, is a reminder that this Messiah has come to restore the sight of those who have been blinded. Blinded just not by physical consequences, but blinded spiritually by power, by unrealistic expectations of others, blinded by the despair of our own lives, or blinded by our own sins. And it's only those who are willing to take a look into the mirror. Take a look into the mirror and look and find that reflection of a humble and repentant disciple. An image, a reflection, a holy reflection of one who worships and praises God, of one who serves humbly and loves abundantly. A disciple, a Christian, who doesn't see glory as a person of power, rather sees glory in the power of a cross. And so, next time you look in the mirror, whether it be these little ones or full length at home, when you look into a mirror, what do you see? Do you see a disciple of Jesus? Even blind Bartimaeus could see that his future was one of discipleship and humble service. And it was his faith that made him both whole and holy. And it's out our faith, coupled with obedience and humble actions, that we will receive God's mercy and grace, the gift of life eternal. In our hymnals again, number 381, open my eyes that I may see. Let's stand as we're comfortable and able. Gracious and merciful God, we thank you for the gift of your Son Jesus in our lives. We thank you, God, for the lessons that he bestows, for the wisdom, your wisdom that he shares. We thank you for his earthly sacrifice that we might enjoy life eternal. We thank you, God, for your spirit that indeed inspires us and embraces us and guides us. child, of being your son's disciples. Holy God, this morning we want to pray for Jeff as he struggles with cancer. Want to pray for the Haitian hostages. We pray for them all, especially keeping close to our minds those from right here in our community. We pray for the prayer vigil later this afternoon. Pray for our Council on Aging that provides such warm and wonderful fellowship. And finally, God, we pray for our Grand West Association as they gather virtually for their fall meeting. We pray for churches of the association, for the members and friends of those congregations, as well as for the leadership that guides them. Indeed, God, we thank you for your abundant mercy in our lives. Pray together, just as Jesus has taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The heavens tell of God's glory. And so here on earth, we must sing our praises of God's glory. And we must share from our abundance for the glory of God and our neighbor's good. Ushers.
the name above all names. Amen.
Amazing grace. Let's sing stanzas 1, 2, 4, and 5, number 202. Are special beyond